Hello friends, welcome back to another video tutorial from Shomu's Biology. And in this video lecture, we want to talk about confocal microscopy. In the last lecture, we have talked about the wide field fluorescence microscopy. I already told you that in fluorescence microscopy, we can visualize the different subcellular compartments of cell and different organelles of cell with great details. But there is a problem and drawback of fluorescence microscopy. What was the drawback? The drawback is in fluorescence microscopy, we use a light excitation energy with one type of wavelength of light that hits the sample, and the sample with the fluorophore emits another wavelength of light that is received by the detector to see the fluorescence. But in this case, the whole sample is showing that or releasing or emitting that fluorophore or fluorescence. So it's very difficult for us to find out the exact location of fluorescence that is coming in. For example, if it's a cell, the cell with a different depth, the depth of the cell in different places are different. And if the cell contains that fluorophore, for example, GFP, green fluorescent protein, is present inside the cell. Now the cell, upon receiving a light or exciter energy, it releases the other wavelength of light or fluorescence. And then the fluorescence is visible throughout of the cell. When we see in the detector, or if you watch it through the microscope, you can see the fluorescence to be present all around the cell. So it's very difficult to find out exact location of fluorescence from the background, because in very simple terms, wide field fluorescence microscopy gives us good data of the subcellular compartments, but with a lot of background noise. What is background noise? Background noise is the unwanted fluorescence coming out from the background portion of the cell or the specimen, along with the actual fluorescence region, actual specimen or region of the specimen from where we want to obtain the fluorescence. So to prevent that, we have a different approach. We use another modified version of this wide field fluorescence microscopy, which is known as confocal microscopy. Okay, we call it confocal microscopy, or it's also known as confocal laser scanning microscopy, okay, CLSM. So these are the type of names that are given to this confocal microscopy. Now in confocal microscopy, there are few differences with the setup of the microscope, and let me tell you about the setup. So I must erase this portion which is not needed here. The idea is the same. We use a light, an energy source, not exactly light but an energy source, to excite the fluorophore that is present in the sample, and then the sample release or emit another light which is recognized by the detector, and we can find the picture. That idea is same, but the light source in this case is different and the setup is a little bit different. What is different? Let's look at it. For a wide field fluorescence microscopy, the light source was white light, but now in this case we use laser. In case of confocal microscopy, we use laser as a light, okay? So laser beam is used. Why we use laser beam? Because the reason we use confocal microscopy is to specific location identity and 3D structure modeling with the help of the confocal microscopy. This is the reason why we use confocal microscopy, why we prefer confocal microscopy over the wide field fluorescence microscopy. Because confocal microscopy can give us very specific location identity inside a cell. So it can eliminate all the background noise and can give us the fluorescence from the exact fluorescence emitting region of the sample. So now, we use laser. Why? Because light can move in any direction, because light, white light, is not specific, right? Even though you use condenser or any other specific point, but still it is not that much focused, while laser is much more focused, right? Laser is so focused that it can even excite small particle inside the mitochondria of our cell. That's very much focused. We cannot achieve that much of thin detail analysis with white light. So that's why we use laser. Another thing is that laser can reach different depth of the cell, because a cell has multiple depth location. As I told you earlier in the last class as well, the cell has multiple depth of field. of the structure. So the laser, based on the intensity, can reach the deepest level of the depth or the shallow depth. Depending upon which depth of field we need, we can tune the laser, and the laser can excite fluorophore or excite any other fluorescence tag, which is most of the time used in this case of confocal microscopy, with the help of immuno tags or antibody mediated tags that are used. Okay, so they are going to focus on very specific region with different depth of field regions. We can do that with laser. We cannot achieve that with light. That's why we substitute light with laser in case of confocal microscopy. Second thing, instead of having excitation filter, there is no excitation filter in this confocal. We do have a similar structure like excitation filter, but in this case we have a small pinhole, a pinhole filter is there, from where a very tiny bit of laser, very focused laser, can hit this mirror reflector again. Through this reflector, it's a dichroic mirror, just like the earlier one for wide field microscopy. So they again reflect it back into the specimen. Now in the specimen, based on the degree and intensity of the laser, the laser can penetrate the skin, laser can penetrate the cell, and can reach the adequate depth of field to give us the exact data. And then once that is excited, okay, immunofluorescence is used most of the time. So generally they are associated with the antibody tag, antibodies tagged with fluorescence dye. Okay, so once they're excited, they emit the light. That emission of the light again passes through the dichroic mirror, hits the detector. But before hitting the detector, there is another pinhole filter is present. There is another pinhole filter here. Okay, this is another pinhole filter. Two pinhole filters are present. One after the laser beam, and second one before the detector. Two pinhole filters. Why? Because in the second pinhole filter, first pinhole filter focuses the laser specifically. Any other background noise is eliminated. While second pinhole filter, so let me write it pinhole filter number 2. Second pinhole filter is present before the detector to again cut out any other unwanted emission of fluorescence. Because other fluorescence also may come from this part, the other fluorescence may come, but those fluorescence, non-specific fluorescence or background fluorescence noise, can be blocked by the presence of the pinhole filter there. It will only allow the emission of from the specific region of the cell to only pass through the pinhole filter and hit the detector. That is the simplest modification of wide field confocal microscopy, wide field fluorescence microscopy into the confocal microscopy. Now during this process of confocal microscopy, as I told you, that in the very general type of microscopy, what happens, this is, let's say, the cell nucleus and all, and this is for the confocal. The idea is, in case of the conventional mode, the light hits the cell, and I mean that emission is there. So emission is possible from different sides, and all the emission will be received by the detector. But in case of the confocal microscopy, the emission, let's say we want to visualize only nucleus, so the other emissions that are coming from different places of the cell will be cut out, only the emission from the nucleus is received. And the position of the nucleus may be on the top of the cell or the bottom of the cell with different depth. We can also achieve that with laser. So if this is the three-dimensional cell, let me draw this three-dimensional cell, this is the nucleus, right? Now if we use the laser, and if the laser only reaches here with this intensity, then we are not going to see any nucleus, because there is no emission from nucleus at this laser intensity. If the laser hits till this depth, but in this location, no intensity. So the laser needs to hit the nucleus with this depth of field, in this depth of field, to reach the nucleus to give us the proper visualization of the nucleus. Then only the fluorophore present in the nucleus or tagged here will showcase or will emit the light, and that's going to be viewed with the help of the detector. And with this idea, for even a single cell, we can change the depth of field by changing the intensity of the laser beam. Changing the intensity of the laser beam, changing the depth of field, means we can change the optical plane. Okay, so the optical plane is like a small region of the cell where we can focus on and can get an image of. So by this fashion, we can use multiple optical plane. And as we use multiple optical plane, we can get multiple pictures from different angles. Okay, so let's say we are getting thousands of pictures of a single cell with different multiple tagged fluorescence, okay, or fluorophores. So with these multiple images, we can combine those images and add them together to form a three-dimensional structure of that cell. It's possible with the help of confocal microscopy. Without using any scanning microscope, you can still get a very good detailed, very sharp image of the cell in a three-dimensional shape with the help of the confocal microscopy, with the help of this technique. And there are software to use compiling all the images. Example of one such software is ZStack. So with multiple dimensional images, we can compact that with ZStack, like softwares like ZStack, to get a 3D image. And those images will be very much concentrated, very detailed about each and every different section of the cell. And one more advantage of confocal over the wide field fluorescence microscopy is that confocal microscopy gives us much sharper images because it cuts out any other unwanted fluorescence from the background. So much more sharper image, specific image, and we can also compile the different optical plane images into a three-dimensional structure of image. That is the beauty of a confocal microscopy, right? So if you want to see the structures of, let's say, cytoskeleton, or let's say we are going to see the structures of the metaphase plate and how the chromosomes are aligned in the metaphase plate and the microtubules are connected to the kinetochore, that kind of structure, it's very well explained and understood with the help of this confocal microscopy. So that's all about confocal microscopy. If you like, share this video with your friends, and do not forget to subscribe to our channel to get more videos like that.